You've been in the job, the CEO job now for what, 2.5 years?
Yeah.
What surprised you about taking over that job?
Well, the role as of CEO is something that many people look forward to and hope to get the chance to do at some point in their careers. But the thing that surprised me about it is, in spite of being on the BT board for 6 years beforehand and knowing the business very well, there were many aspects of the job that have not been things I've come across before, to be perfectly honest. And the very nature of the CEO and its position in the organisation is different from any role I'd done before.
So the buck stops with you, effectively, now?
Absolutely, and there are so many things that are going on at any one time, so many things that could go wrong. You have to get attuned to knowing when to let something go and when to really dive in deep and get involved in something. So it's unlike any job, and your relationship with the organisation is very different. So as a head of a division, you work with your peers across the business, and they can act as confidants and advisors and supporters. You don't have that role with anybody else when you're the CEO.
Yes, you have to. You're not one of the lads anymore.
Sadly, not.
No.
And your relationship with the board is very different.
Yeah.
Than your relationship with a traditional boss. They're there to challenge you, to push you, to provide governance and ensure that you've really tested your decisions. And as such, they're not there to, in many ways, train and develop you in the same way. So it takes a bit of getting used to. But having been round the block twice now and coming into my halfway through my third year in the job, I can, I'm feeling a little bit more sure of what to do.
I think the average tenure for a CEO now is about 3.5 years, isn't it? So you.
I don't know where you're going with that, Tim, but I'm not sure I'm completely comfortable.
Okay, now, what struck me about... The reason I asked that is what struck me about this while I was doing some of the research is looking at the size of the bets that you place, which are enormous, even by large company terms. If you're looking at, say, acquisitions like EE, that's what, $12.5 billion? And even just, buying the football rights, you're into the billions already. So you're making... So there's a huge risk in getting it wrong. There's a risk, there's a sort of existential risk in getting it wrong, isn't there? How do you cope with that? What information do you need to base to make those decisions with confidence?
Well, you never make them with complete confidence. I think the key to good decision-making is ultimately it's a combination of the rational arguments and your intuitive instincts and using a combination of the both to make the decision. And then really focusing as CEO on the big ones and trying to get those right and make sure that you're not distracted by the little ones that do bubble up to you at all times and in many cases don't really need your involvement. Oh. It's a mixture of effectiveness in some ways in terms of getting the big ones right and efficiency for all the smaller ones.
Because the big ones, when you commit these investments, you can't uncommit them. You can't put a fibre network in the ground for a few months to see if anyone likes it.
Yeah, but they're rarely binary.
Yeah.
And that's the key. It's the nature of the industry is it's a very dynamic one. At any one time, there's a complete change in the competitive set that you're operating with. I've been in this industry for 15 years and in BT for 12. And, the competitors that I faced in the first couple of years, were the likes of British Gas and was the biggest competitor of the consumer business, for example. And fast forward 10, 12 years and, it's a completely different set of competitors. And the competitors have come in and gone out and come back in again. And so it's a very dynamic marketplace, big changes in technology, significant changes in regulation, and yet you've got to make decisions that have 10 to 15 year paybacks. And it's getting that balance right of long term plus short term agility is part of the art, I think.
So what information is useful to you? Because if what customers want changes, what you can do changes, the people you're competing against changes, and people can't possibly tell you what they are going to want in 10 years' time. What information can you use? What hard information can you use?
Well, the fundamentals of understanding your customers, anticipating what their unmet needs are, working with them to develop products and services that meet those needs, give them better value, help them do more in their businesses, in their lives. Those are true. They're true in everybody's businesses, I think, around the room, and they're true in our sector as well. And so sticking to that is key. I think, I believe that great marketing-led businesses are able to develop people who've got great instincts for what people buy. So they understand what the data tells them, but they've also honed over a period of time an ability to look at a proposition or a product and work out actually instinctively whether people will buy it. I think that's something I look for in the people who work in the business, particularly on the customer-facing units. And then you've got to make some bets on long-term trends, and one of them is the consumption of data, which, if you look over the last 15 years, has been growing at 50% a year pretty consistently. And if you're in the business of selling data, then you've got to figure out how to get more ubiquitous data at lower prices, available seamlessly across your markets. So there are certain macro trends you focus on, and then really try and adapt your propositions as you learn more and more about what your customers want.
So you use the word ubiquitous there, and one of the things that you're constantly being asked about, and there's that constant news coverage about, is because you are an infrastructure, you are the nation's infrastructure provider for data, you're always being asked about what about people in this place and that place, their broadband speeds are slow, that sort of thing. Does the data show that affects the reputation, the image of BT, what people think of it?
Yeah, it does. And we're not, I know we're portrayed as the only infrastructure provider. Of course we're not. There are, there's Virgin Media that covers 50% of the country today and is planning to go beyond that towards 60%. There are many infrastructure overbuilders that are building fibre networks. So it is a little, in some ways it's portrayed as there's no choice, but it's true we are the only national provider in that respect. But there are alternatives for people, there's no question about that. And of course, our networks are available to every service provider in the market on an equivalent basis. So the choice actually to a consumer is quite significant ultimately.
Well, my question was slightly different. It's kind of, do you take a reputational hit from this?
I think when there's criticism around that is being made at us by MPs or some of our competitors, particularly over the last year, as Ofcom have been undertaking their 10-year review, there are times that has affected us reputationally. But the challenge for us is to make sure that the debate is one that's fact-based and is not opportunistic and an attempt to gain competitive advantage. I mean, it's too important for that. And it's important that the underlying fact base is consistent. And if you look at Ofcom's data or the EU data, the UK is, it's the most digitally developed nation in the G20, for example. So more of the economy is dependent on the internet than any of the other G20 countries. We've got the most extensive superfast network in Europe. We've got the fastest take-up. We've got the lowest prices and the most choice. And that's not our data, that's Ofcom. So it just needs to be an informed debate. That's all I'm asking.
Yeah. I asked you just now whether people come up to your parties and tell you their broadband speed. Yeah.
I'm that boring that that's what they talk to me about.
Yeah. Don't do this. You're saying that BT has to respond to these sort of things. Now, would you call BT an innovative company?
I would. BT has been around since the mid-1800s. It was the first telecom company in the world. And if you look at a number of the innovations that have changed our industry, BT has been right at the forefront of those. Be that the first telegraph itself, the first programmable computer is a BT invention, Colossus. The first fiber networks were based on BT patents, for example. So the company has been, from a technology perspective, right at the forefront of a number of the important changes that have changed the whole industry, the whole world. So, yes, it has, and it is managed to reinvent itself a number of times. So,
that's
the key to survival.
That's interesting because when you were in charge of BT Vision, you came in with a different kind of innovation, sort of service innovation, really, didn't you? Where you managed to sort of package up something new, buying football rights, bundling that up with broadband as a way of developing the business. Does this show that BT is now innovating in a slightly different way?
Well, I think innovation isn't the sole responsibility of your R&D function. I mean, great companies have leadership throughout their business, but also an ability to innovate at all parts of the value chain. And innovating at a proposition level is as important as innovating at a technology level.
Does that message get all the way through BT now?
I wouldn't say our work is done, no. I think in parts of the culture, it is a very dynamic, customer-oriented and in many ways a very high-performing culture. In other parts, we've got work to do, I would say.
Which bits?
I think it would be unfair to use this as a sort of annual review for...
It's all right. No one's going to tell. No one's going to say anything.
I think the point is this, is great businesses are able to flourish over the long term because at their heart, it's not because they've got a technology advantage or a product advantage, or in many ways, it's not down to individual people. It is about having a culture that can sustain itself, reinvent itself, and always anticipate the next trend. And that's the only source of competitive advantage you can rely on.
I hear increasingly from companies that are built around innovation about their agile processes, about how they use insight, they wrap it into the process of iterative process of creating new products and services. Can BT ever do something like that? You're what, 88,000 people, something like that?
Over 100.
100, more than 100,000 people.
Absolutely, and our access to data is up there amongst the top that you could get available if you think about it. So the key is not data, the key is insight. Mm-hmm. We're in a world where it's awash with data. What you need to be able to identify, I think, is the signal from the noise. That's where the real skill is, and that's a thinking process.
What's the signal at the moment that you just can't identify? What is the thing that you really need to know but can't get a handle on?
Well, I think as a CEO, it goes back to what is your core responsibility, and as a CEO, you're really judged on what you leave behind. Fundamentally, it's you need to do a good job while you're there. But ultimately, you're a steward of the business, and it's how you hand it over. And in many ways, it's in its broadest term, it's the balance sheet you give your successor is what you're really judged on. So, ensuring that I'm able to help the organization make the right choices for a 10-year horizon is the key. This doesn't mean we don't focus on things in the immediate future. Of course we do. But you know, those are the difficult calls, making sure that actually you've put the right investments down, you've ensured that actually whoever does succeed me is in a position to, you know, run with the ball immediately is the most difficult thing, I think.
Is it getting more difficult to do that when careers are shorter as well now? In the old days, people would work for BT their entire lives. So making changes over 10 years, well, that's all contained within their careers. If you're doing something that's going to make a change in 10 years' time, you might not be there. The rest of your board might not be there, and very few of the people working for BT now would be there. How do you get the incentive to be able to make those investments?
If I had to push back a little bit, I mean, careers, if anything, are longer. I think people move around a wee bit more than they used to. But a business like ours is able to offer people interesting work over 30 and 40 years. And, you know, as a big employer, one of the biggest employers in the UK, with high paid R&D and management jobs in the UK, it has a lot that's appealing to people who want to base themselves in the UK. And we serve customers in over 170 markets around the world, so we've got a lot of overseas opportunities as well. So it is quite I think we've got a lot to offer somebody who wants an interesting, challenging career, if they don't necessarily have to, they don't necessarily have to leave the firm per se. But to answer the specifics of your question, I think it's all to do with ultimately how you measure people and ensure that they make those decisions over the long term. So it's common practice now for executives to have to retain shares in the business long after they've left the business, and that ultimately they can benefit or suffer if the decisions they've made subsequently turn out to be the wrong ones. And indeed, if there's something like fraud, the money can be recouped as such and taken back. So I think that's the key. You've got to get the incentivization right. You've got to get the culture right. You've got to ensure that the values are right, and recognize that people don't come to work simply to make money. They come to work to have, to realize a purpose, I think, ultimately.
Let's go to the room. Who's got a question for Gavin now? We have we've got about 5 minutes where you can ask questions. If you stick your hand up, wait for the microphone, identify yourself and ask a question, then that's good. We have one here in the middle, just after the person with the microphone went in the other direction. Perfect. If you let us know who you are as well.
Hi, Sam. I'm Joris from IC. As we are here in a room with a lot of insights and research people, I was wondering, within the top management of BT, what are the top priorities and cool topics in terms of analytics and research especially? Yeah, if you can elaborate a little bit on that. But sure. That goes also to the top management, that would be very, very nice.
Yeah, good question.
Well, I think the most important trend in a business like ours is how do we use this huge bank of data that we have on customers and prospective customers and turn that into operational insight that allows us to better meet the needs of our customers, be that the propositions and products and services we develop, and how we market those ultimately, how we build demand for those through the business. We're now a business of, on the consumer side, 10 million fixed customers, 25 million mobile customers. We've got a huge amount of data in terms of what their viewing habits are through our content as well. And that should give you a very, very rich picture, ultimately, of...
Well, it should, but often you have so much data.
Well, it goes to the point I was saying, which is it's making it actionable. Mm. It's making it into a series of choices, turning it into a series of choices that actually allow you to get a better return on investment. That's the real key. It's not more data, it's better decisions that you need to make.
Mm. Now, do we have another question? One down here in the front. Yes, you're local for the microphone now. Thank you.
Hello, Samantha Smith from GoSpot Check and Redroot. I'm sorry, I'm going to ask you about broadband speed. Sorry, it's not a dinner party either. I've just been working in America for many, many years, and of course you know the situation there with Verizon and everything, where they are. They are achieving amazing, amazing fast broadband. So what do you think you're going to be doing it over the next 5-10 years?
Well, let me be clear. America is a long way behind here in terms of broadband speeds. It's fine if you live in a Verizon neighborhood, but sadly they don't cover the 350 million people in the US. Look, in the UK, the point I was making earlier, 90% of the UK is covered by Superfast today. Within the next 18 months, that will be 95% of the UK. And we will work with government to try and get to the last 5%. Now, that, compared with any country around the world, is the most extensive coverage. And it's the benefits of the internet are that it's a network, that it's hard. It's not the speed itself. That is important, but it's more important that you get reach at the right speed, but reach is more important ultimately. We're not stopping there. We are poised to go from the current speeds, which are around up to 80 megabits per second. We've been testing speeds of about half a gigabit per second and more, and we'll begin to roll those out hopefully later this year. And we've got a stated goal to get to 10 million premises by 2020. We now have acquired EE, which has the most extensive 4G network in the UK. There are a number of upgrades to the speeds that will be able to deliver, and most importantly, the coverage that you'll be able to get on that, geographical coverage that will be rolled out over the next 18 months. Which I think will make a huge difference, because at the moment 4G has it has 95% coverage in terms of people and where people live, but that doesn't translate to always where people use the networks, which is one of the frustrations. And then ultimately, towards the end of the decade, we'll be rolling out 5G, which, when combined with the sort of fixed speeds we're talking about, that is when you get to this ubiquitous, seamless network. Where you stop asking me about questions about broadband speeds.
And on that, we're out of time, aren't we? Because you have a hard finish. You've got somewhere to go, don't you?
I do, yeah. I can't be late.
Common Select Committee. So I think we better let
you
go.
Very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please say thank you for the Chief Executive of BT Group, Gavin Patterson. Gavin.